Hello from my side. My name is George Huber from Infineon. I work with our software partners for Aurix, like Electrobit, to support them developing solutions for the Aurix ecosystem.
Good afternoon also from the Electrobit side. My name is Michael Reis and I've been working for Electrobit since the year 2008. In the last 10 years, I was involved in several AUTOSAR ECU projects for different OEMs, which were based on the AUTOSAR Classic platform. I've started with the AUTOSAR stack based on the specification 2.1, then of course switched to AUTOSAR 3, and in the meantime, all the projects are using the AUTOSAR 4 stack. Let's have a look on the agenda, which is planned for our webinar. To start with, we would like to talk about the Aurix multi-core architecture. After that, we will give you an overview about possible multi-core software architectures and the software architecture of the demo project we want to use in this webinar. Then we will cover the AUTOSAR basic software modules and especially their configurations in a multi-core architecture. Afterwards, we want to outline some performance aspects, especially the core local memories, which are available on the Aurix controller. Of course, we want to show you also the running demo on the Aurix hardware. And afterwards, we want to summarize the webinar a little bit and answer all your questions. But let's start with the first point. And this is the point about the Aurix multi-core architecture. And Georg Huber will give us this overview.
Yeah, thank you, Michael. I would like to start with the hardware and give an overview of the Aurix multi-core architecture. Aurix differentiates mainly through the high computing power of the tri-cores, the real-time performance with shortest reaction times of the events and guaranteed response times to events, and of course the comprehensive safety features. This picture shows the block diagram of a TC39X, a high-end derivative of the Aurix TC3X family. We have here 6 cores. Other derivatives with less cores are also available. The cores are directly connected to the internal RAMs and flash memory. And the tri-core and the memory is also connected to the system interconnectors. Then we have here other types of memories, the MCDS, the DMA, fast communication interfaces, and we have here the set of peripherals that are connected to the system peripheral bus, and a bridge that connects both buses together. All Aurix derivatives are ASIL-D compliant via lockstep or checker cores, and by other comprehensive hardware mechanisms to detect or avoid failures. There is also a hardware secure module as a trust anchor available. This module has an own processor and crypto accelerators, a true random generator and secured memory for key storage, and is also protected via firewall. So Aurix is also well known as a scalable architecture. It scales over the cores, the package and the peripheral tailored to various applications. The Aurix target applications are powertrain, including electric vehicle, advanced driver assist systems, including autonomous driving and connectivity. Also braking, power steering and chassis applications, and applications that require high passive safety level are target applications for the Aurix multi-core architecture. So Aurix has a unique architecture to achieve best possible performance from the available cores. As said before, all cores have access to the entire 32-bit address space. Now the on-chip memory is partitioned that each core has access to a fraction of the on-chip memory. We call this local memory. This is RAM and this is flash. Now when locating the code and the data into the memory that is executed and processed by the respective core that is directly connected to the local memory, the ideal multi-core performance can be utilized. This means, in such case, the available performance increases linearly with the number of cores. The real achievable performance by multi-cores might deviate a bit from the linear curve because of inter-processor activities, or code or data can always not be optimally located. But in many applications, it is possible to be very close to the linear curve. So from a pure hardware perspective, AURIC's multi-core architecture allows the highest possible performance utilization of the additional cores on the SoC. Utilization of the additional performance is depending on the software use cases and the software and tool support to partition the software objects to different cores. Now Michael Reis from Electrobit will show different use cases and how software can be partitioned to different cores in the context of AUTOSAR. Michael Reis, please go ahead.
Thanks, Georg, for this introduction of the AURIC's controller itself. So now we have learned the internal architecture of the AURIC's controller, and now we want to switch to the software architecture. On this slide, you can see that there are different ways possible how to build a multi-core system in software. Let's start with the picture on the left side. It has the title Separate Core Usage. What does it mean? Here we can see a use case which was quite common in the projects a few years ago. The AUTOSAR basic software, so we can see it here on the left side, was running only on one core, and let's say there was a separation between any other core which was used in the project. On the other cores, maybe there was the need to reuse an existing application which was not developed according to AUTOSAR. So finally, each core has executed its own software, and in case of some communication interfaces between these two software parts, it was of course required to realize an own data exchange mechanism. By the way, on this slide, we can always see that only two cores are utilized. This shows only an example. Of course, it is possible to use all the cores which are provided from the Infineon AURIC processor. Let's switch to the second approach, which is called distributed application. So it is shown in the middle. Here we can see an approach which is quite often used in projects which are currently in development or which already starts the production phase. What does it mean to distribute the application? First of all, the goal is to have a full AUTOSAR system. But due to the fact that the large amount of software components or the functionalities which are required in the vehicle exceeds the computational power of a single core, it is maybe required to distribute our software components, so our application components, on different cores. And this is exactly the picture we can see in the middle on this slide. On the one hand, we need, of course, an operating system which is capable, let's say, to schedule the application components which are distributed on different cores. This is realized from the multi-core operating system. And finally, we have software components which are executed on different cores. The AUTOSAR runtime environment, which is shown here, takes care that the communication between all these software components can be established. From the software component point of view, it doesn't matter on which core they are deployed. The communication API is transparent, and it is always the same, completely independent from the core deployment. Now let's switch to the next use case, which we can see on the right side on this slide. Here we have a quite similar approach as for the distributed application. But additionally, we also want to distribute the basic software stack from AUTOSAR. Why could this be helpful to distribute also the basic software? So that means all the parts which are located below the RTE. Let's assume we have to realize a gateway ECU. And this gateway ECU has a very high demand on the communication networks. So maybe the demand is such high that it is not possible to fulfill all the communication network requirements on a single core. Then it would be great if we can separate or utilize the different communication networks on different cores. And so finally reduce the CPU load on the core dramatically. So let's say we distribute the CPU load on the different cores also from the basic software perspective. Let's continue with the distributed application and the distributed basic software. Which goals you may have in your multi-core project? Maybe there is the requirement to start all the software components which are now located on different cores in a, let's say, synchronized way. So we have the requirement that the software components on the core 0 shall be started more or less in the same moment as the software components which are located on the core 1. The responsibility to start the software components or to start the runtime environment is part of the basic software module. In this case, it's the basic software mode manager, BSWM. That means the basic software mode manager needs the capability to take input values from the local core and also from other cores into account. And based on the different input values, it performs an appropriate reaction. So it starts the execution of the software components on the core 1 and on the core 0. Well, let's consider another requirement. Maybe we have the need to monitor the execution of our software components, which are now distributed on the different cores. So that means the internal or the external watchdog, which is used in your ECU project, shall only be triggered if every software component, which is part of your project, is working properly. Maybe it is also necessary to monitor the execution order. So just to define a so-called control flow graph and also define a control flow graph which crosses the core boundaries so that we can monitor if, for example, the software component on the core 0 executes, first of all, an input function. Maybe our calculation component is located on another core, so afterwards this component shall be executed, and the results are finally distributed again via a component which is located on the core 0. So finally, the monitoring aspect has to take into account that the software component status is monitored from every core, and the decision is taken if the watchdog shall be triggered or shouldn't be triggered anymore. Here we can have a deeper look into the EB architecture for the AUTOSAR mode management stack. So how does Electrobit has implemented the possibility to distribute the modules ECUM, which stands for ECU State Manager, and the basic software mode manager, BSWM. For the ECUM module, a so-called master-slave approach is implemented. Means in AUTOSAR we have a master core. In this picture, it is the core 0, which acts as a master core. On the master core, the ECUM master instance is executed. So we can see it here. The ECUM master itself is responsible for starting all the other cores which are used in our ECU project. And of course, it is also responsible to start, let's say, the core local operating system. On our core one, we do have a so-called ECUM satellite module. So on the core one, for example, it is not necessary anymore to start the other cores because this was already done from the master core. But of course, we have to start also the operating system on the core one. And this is now in the responsibility of the ECUM satellite component. For the basics of our mode manager, which is also part of the mode management stack in the classic Althusser, we have implemented another approach. For the basics of our mode manager, you really have the possibility to have an own instance on each core or in each partition. This means that you can define and of course configure an own rule set for each basic software mode manager instance. Now it may happen that there is the need to forward or to transfer a mode which is, let's say, produced from the basic software mode manager on the core 0 to the basic software mode manager instance which is executed on the core 1. This is of course possible and it is a valid use case. In such a moment, the basic software mode manager will involve the basic software scheduler from Althusser, which is implemented in the runtime environment. So it is also called schedule manager. The basic software scheduler finally will realize the cross-core communication. And later on in the demo project of our webinar, we will see how this cross-core communication is implemented. As a second example, let's have a deeper look into the communication stack from Electrobit. I've already mentioned the idea that we want to separate the communication stack network types on different cores. Here we can see the picture. So we have one communication network type on the core 0. So let's assume this is our CAN communication stack, and we have another communication network type on the core 1. Let's assume this is the Ethernet stack in the classic Althusser platform. Now we can think about different use cases. So maybe this software component in our application, which is deployed to the core 0, wants to transmit a PDU via the CAN network. Then we can see that it is not necessary to have any cross-core communication. The software component is part of the core 0, and also the CAN communication stack is part of the core 0. So it can directly transmit the information via the core module to the PDU router and then to their involved CAN communication modules. But let's consider another use case. The software component on the core 1, this one here, has the need to transmit the same message, the same PDU on two different communication networks. In Althusser, of course, this is allowed. It's a typical multicast transmission, and this multicast transmission can be realized in the PDU router, as it is shown on the slide. The PDU router on the core 1 will of course forward directly the message to the Ethernet stack. And additionally, it will notify the PDU router on the other core that it is also required to transmit the message on the CAN network. So finally, the PDU router will redirect the request additionally to the core 0. The EB solution is of course also prepared for gateway use cases, and this is shown with the blue arrows here. So on the one hand, in Althusser, it is possible to realize a so-called PDU gateway, which is realized again in the PDU router. Of course, if we have such a gateway situation, then the PDU router located on core 0 and the PDU router located on core 1 is involved. And the same statement is true for the so-called signal gateway, which must be realized in the core module. So let's assume we receive a signal on the CAN network and we shall forward this signal also on the Ethernet network. Then the COM module on the core 0 will take care that this signal, let's say, is transferred to the COM module of the core 1, and that this COM module packs the signal into a new PDU, which is finally transmitted on the Ethernet network. Even if such a solution isn't part of the latest AUTOSAR release, Electrobit has already implemented such a support, and of course you can use it if you have such a use case in your project. Now let's switch to the demo project we want to present during this webinar. I've tried to draw a little bit the workflow. First of all, we want to create a classic AUTOSAR project. So we need some software components which are responsible to realize a functionality. These software components are described in a so-called system description, and this system description was prepared with the Joule System Desk from DSpace. This information is now imported into EB Treso Studio. This is the AUTOSAR basic software configuration tool from Electrobit. Within EB Treso Studio, you have the possibility to configure the whole Electrobit basic software, as well as the microcontroller abstraction layer drivers, which are delivered from Infineon. So you don't have to switch the tool. You can configure the whole basic software stack in one tool. After finishing the configuration, you can generate the source code and the header files for your project. So this is finally the output from EB Treso Studio. And of course, this will be the input for our compiler and linker. We compile and link the project, and as this output, we will get an ELF file, which is finally flashed to our target hardware. I have used the Lauterbach debugger to do that. Therefore, I've mentioned here also the tool Trace32. So I downloaded the software to my Infineon tripod, and this Infineon tripod is equipped with an RX TC38X processor. Later on, we will see that I have also integrated two different communication stacks in this demo project. One of these stacks is the Ethernet stack, and therefore we can monitor the Ethernet traffic with a free tool like Wireshark. Let's go on with the software architecture, which was chosen for this demo project. First of all, you can see that we use the approach number 3 in one of my first, or from my first slide. That means we have a distributed application. So these application components are distributed over the cores. And additionally, I have also distributed some of the basic software modules. So we can see this for the mode management stack. So we have one basic software mode manager instance on the core 0 and another one on the core 1. We have our ECUM master on the core 0 and our ECUM satellite on the core number 1. And of course, we have to use an operating system which is capable for the multi-core approach. So which is able to schedule the functionalities on the core 0 and on the core 1. Later on, I will also explain the different software components. But first of all, let's switch to the next slide, which shows in more detail the startup phase of an AUTOSAR multi-core system. We have again on the left side our core 0. Here I've mentioned that that is the master core, and on the right side the core 1. On both cores, we have implemented our main function. So we can see it here. Here we have the main function. The main function is typically directly invoked from the startup code. And let's say it's the entry point for the APIs, for the AUTOSAR APIs, which will be invoked. In an AutoSAR system, the implementation of the main function is really pretty simple. You only have to invoke the ECM init function. This is an API which is provided from the ECU state manager module. In the very first step, only the master core is running. So only the master core will jump into the main function and will execute the ECM init function. Then we step into the ECM module, where we will find the ECM init implementation. So we don't have to implement it by our own. This was already done from ElectroBit. First of all, the ECM on the master core is responsible to start all the other cores which are used in this project. Therefore, the API start core is invoked. Exactly after that point, both cores are running in parallel. That means now the second core, the core number one, will also jump into the main function from its own startup code and will also invoke the ECM init function. But let's switch first of all back to the master core. After starting all the other cores, the ECM module will start the operating system by invoking the API from the OS, which is called start OS. And now the operating system will run on the core zero. On the core one, we have exactly the same behavior. So also on the core one, start operating system is invoked. And also on the core one, the operating system will be started in this moment. Of course, to enable this functionality, we have to consider also the impact to the configuration. And to explain this a little bit, I have prepared some screenshots from the basic software module configuration in EbiTrace Studio. And I want to start with the ECM module configuration. We have to inform the ECM somehow that we want to use this multi-core functionality, so that we need an ECM master and satellite module. Here you can already see the configuration parameter which must be enabled for this use case. The parameter is called enable multi-core functionality, and in our demo project I have set this configuration parameter of course to true. Let's switch to the multi-core operating system itself. The AutoSAR multi-core operating system is targeted at embedded systems with hard real-time constraints. The most important fact is that in the classic platform, we have a static operating system, which means on the one hand that we always have a deterministic runtime behavior. But on the other hand, due to this static approach, it is of course required that the integrator of the ECU software must specify all the required OS objects, so for example tasks or interrupt service routines, before the system itself is built. When the operating system is configured, you also have to do, let's say, the core assignment. So when you configure a task, you also have to define on which core this task shall be executed. In AutoSAR, you have to use the so-called applications to group OS objects logically together. So that means an OS application is just a group of OS objects, and the whole OS application is later on assigned to a dedicated core in your system. Of course, it is also possible to define several OS applications which will be assigned to exactly the same core. Later on, we will see on the slide that this is very often required in safety critical ECUs. So let's have a look to the configuration. So I have created an OS application with the name Core Zero. I have created several tasks and I have mapped, for example, the task with the name init task core zero to the OS application core zero. And I've did exactly the same for the core one. I have created an OS application core one and the init task core one was mapped to to this OS application core. By the way, as you can see, you have to do this also for the interrupt service routines which are configured in your system, as well as for all the counters, schedule tables, alarms, and so on. Here we can already see, let's say one disadvantage of the operating system due to the fact that we have a static approach. In the AUTOSAR operating system, it is not possible to perform a load balancing during the runtime. So it is not possible in the AUTOSAR operating system that one task checks on which core currently the CPU load is very low, and on this core the task is executed. This is not possible. You already have to assign the core to an application and so also to the task during the configuration time. And the task itself will always be executed on this core. Also here I have prepared some screenshots that you get an impression what is required in the configuration of the operating system. So on the one hand, in the configuration of the operating system, there is a parameter available which is called OS number of cores. You will find this parameter in the tab OS OS. And for our demo project, I have defined that I want to use or utilize two cores. Now let's have a look into the OS applications I have created. So on the left side, we can see the OS application for the core 0. So the name is stated here. And I've mentioned on the previous slide that it is necessary to assign the whole OS application to a core. This is realized with the configuration parameter OS application core assignment. So I have configured that the OS application core 0 shall run on the core 0. In the screenshot on the right side, so here, I'm still in my OS application core 0 configuration. And here I have referenced all the tasks which belong to this OS application core 0. So which finally means here you can see the list of tasks which will be executed on the core 0 later on. This is just a reference to another place in the OS configuration, so we can't see the task properties like priority or if the task is preemptive or non-preemptive in this view. The cores are started now. The operating system is already running, but one important fact is missing, and this is the RTE. So the runtime environment is later on responsible to execute all the software components, so all the functionalities, the application components, which are part of our project. Therefore, we also have to consider to start the runtime environment itself. Starting with the AUTOSAR 4 standard and the flexible ECU state manager concept, the ECU state manager is no longer responsible to start the RTE module. This responsibility was, let's say, forwarded to the basic software mode manager, to the BSWM. How does it work? On the previous slide, we already saw that an init task is configured for each core. Let's start again on the left side with the core 0. So the init task core 0 is executed as soon as the operating system was started. How to realize such an init task? That's really easy. In the configuration, you just have to mark this task as a so-called auto start task. And then the operating system will immediately activate this task after the operating system was started. The init task must first of all inform the ECM that the operating system is running now. Again, this is an API which is provided from the ECM module. It's called ECM Startup 2. And this ECM Startup 2, sorry, this is a mistake here. This is the implementation of the ECM Startup 2. This API invokes the schedule manager init function and the basic software mode manager init function. This is a very general concept in AUTOSAR that nearly all of the basic software models have an own init function, and only if you have executed this init function, the modules will work properly. I've mentioned that finally the basic software mode manager is responsible to start the RTE. How is it realized? We can see a second invocation in the init task of the core zero, which is called BSWM request mode. If this mode request is called from the init task, then the basic software mode manager, will evaluate some rules which are configured for this basic software mode manager instance. And if the condition is fulfilled, then it will perform an action. And here we have configured the basic software mode manager in such a way that, first of all, it shall start the runtime environment, which belongs to the core zero. And we can see a second action which is configured. Here it is called schedule manager switch. And this API is now used to notify my second core, the core number one, so that the core number one knows, okay, now it is also necessary to start the runtime environment on my second core. By using such an approach, we can realize that the RTEs on both cores are started more or less at the same time. Of course, here we can already see that a cross-core communication is needed. So the core zero requests something. This request is forwarded to the core one, and the basic software module instance located on the core one will evaluate this request and will again perform an action to start the runtime environment. Also here we can have a short look into the configuration which was prepared for the demo project. In the EB solution, the basic software module configuration can be easily created using, a pseudo language instead of considering all the quite confusing AUTOSAR configuration model. Here we can see a screenshot of this special editor, and you can see that it is really simple to describe some rules which shall be evaluated from the basic software mode manager. On the one hand, we can see that we can define an own rule set for both instances. So on the left side, the instance on the core zero is selected. On the right side, we can see the instance for the core one is selected. And let us focus on the actions which were described on the previous slide. So if the rule is evaluated to true, let's assume this is the case, then a user callout function is invoked. And in this user callout function, we finally start the runtime environment. And additionally, there is a so-called schedule manager switch action configured. And with this schedule manager switch action, we can inform our core one. Now let's switch to this configuration. Also here we have a rule, and it says if the mode which was set from the core zero, so from this core, fits to the mode which is specified here, then the core number one shall also start the RTE. So both cores will finally call exactly or invoke exactly the same API to start the RTE. How does it work? So how does the RTE know for which core or for which partition it shall be started? Let's have a look in the generated code. Then we will see the simple approach which is used. We know the function is called RTE start. And here we can already see that a switch is implemented automatically in the generated source code. That means the RTE uses an API provided from the operating system, which is called getCoreID. And with this operating system API, it knows on which core this function was invoked. And depending on the return value, so in the demo project, it will be 0 or 1, it will start the RTE which belongs to this application, so which belongs to this core. Now let's switch to the application layer. I've already mentioned that I have modeled the software components used in this demo project with the 2D space system desk, and I've took a screenshot from the software components which I used. There are two components which produce an input value for an algorithm which is implemented in this calculate component. So there is a component, software component calculate, and this component gets two input values. One input value is provided from the software component data provider 1. The other one is provided from the software component data provider 2. The result of this calculation is written to another software component which is called send to com. So the result is consumed from this software component, and this software component will finally transmit the calculation result to, let's say, other ECUs in the network via the CAN and also the Ethernet network. Additionally, I have prepared two further components which, yeah, let's say, shall visualize the data which is provided from the data provider 1 and 2. So here you can see, let's say, a feedback loop, and via the software component data provider output 1 and this I/O hardware abstraction component, I will control some of the LEDs which are assembled on the tri-board. At the moment, in the screenshots on the previous slide, we saw that the software components are not mapped to a dedicated partition or a dedicated core on the RX. If we want to realize that, then we have to go into the RTE configuration. Here we can see again a screenshot of the RTE editor. Also here, we provide you a simplified view on the quite complex AUTOSAR data model, so that it is very easy to assign, let's say, software components to a dedicated OS application or partition. So we can see a list of all the software components here, and the RTE editor provides us the possibility to assign this software component to a configured OS application. And please remember that we have mapped this OS application to a core, and due to this fact, now we map our software components to different cores. So we can see the calculate component runs on core 1, the send to com component runs on core 0. We have already heard that each partition has an own RTE. So we saw that it is necessary to start the RTE on each core, on each partition. So at the end, we will have the following architecture in our multi-core project. So the architecture you can see now on the right side of this slide. So here we have again, four software components, two software components are assigned to core 0 and two software components are assigned to core 1. And we have two different RTEs. We have one RTE for the core 0 and one RTE for the core 1. Here we can already see that we may have two different kinds of communication relationship. It is possible that the producer of some data, so this software component, is located on the same core as the software component which consumes the data. So we have exactly this path. So by the way, all the communication between two software components is always handled via the RTE. In AUTOSAR, it is forbidden that there is a direct communication between two software components. This kind of communication, so the producer and the consumer of the data is located on this, in the same partition, on the same core, is called intra-partition communication. Of course, we can also have the use case that the producer of the data, so let's check this software component, is located on another core than the consumer of the data. Then we can see that both RTEs, so the RTE on the partition 1, on the core 1, is involved, and also the RTE on the partition 0 is involved. This kind of communication is called inter-partition communication. And of course, it requires somehow a communication channel between these two RTEs, which are involved in the communication. And the communication channel is already shown on this picture. In the ElectroBit solution, you can select between different mechanisms. One mechanism is called IOC. It stands for Inter-OS Application Communicator. And this is a mechanism which is provided from the multi-core operating system. There's a second mechanism, which is called SMC, which stands for Shared Memory Communicator. And this mechanism is implemented in the RTE itself, or is part of the RTE implementation. So if we have such a communication path, a so-called inter-partition communication path, then it's obvious that both RTEs are involved and that we need a communication channel for the data transfer between these two RTEs. So let's complete our block diagram we've already saw before. Now I have also marked the core assignment, so we can see that the data provider one component belongs to core one, so this one belongs to the core one. The data provider two component belongs to the core one. The component calculate itself is located on the core one, and the component send to com is located on the core zero. Depending on the core assignment of the software components, we have both types of the communication now. On the one hand, we have communication between software components which are located on the same partition, on the same core. So we have an intra-partition communication, which is marked here with the red color. So every time when you can see an assembly connector which is marked with the red color, then we have an intra-partition communication. And only one RTE is involved. But we can also see the situation that the data provider 1 on the core 0 provides some data for the software component calculate, which is located on the core 1. And then we have a so-called inter-partition communication. Here it is marked with the green color. So every time when you see an assembly connector with green color, it means inter-partition communication. Let's concentrate on the inter-partition communication. We have two components, the calculate component, the send to com component. And we know the calculate component provides some data. This is written into, let's say, the RTE of the core one, so the partition one. This data is transferred to our core zero by using the shared memory communicator or the IOC mechanism. The core zero reads this data inside the RTE and provides the data in a transparent way to our software component sent to com. Where to define the communication mechanism? You can configure it, of course, and this is possible again in the RTE editor. So we can see it on the left side again. Here we have a screenshot of our RTE editor. I have selected the partitioning tab, and in the partitioning tab, there's a configuration parameter available, which is called partitioning support, where you can select which communication type shall be used. For the demo project, I have used the IOC mechanism, which is part of the multi-core operating system. Of course, this will also have an impact to the OS configuration itself, because the OS must be aware of all the IOC channels which are required for our demo project. But is it now necessary to have any knowledge about the data which is exchanged between the partitions so that you can configure all the required IOC channels? Luckily not. So the RTE is already aware of all the communication relationships, and so it is not necessary that the integrator of the software has to provide additional input. That means after you have deployed the software components to the different partitions, to the different cores, you can run a wizard which is called service need wizard, and this service need wizard will automatically create all the required IOC channels in the OS configuration. To finish the topic about the interpartition communication, I have also added a sequence diagram in this webinar which shows just the communication APIs which are invoked. On the left hand, we can see again our software component calculate, which provides some data. It uses the API you may know. So we have a sender receiver communication here, and therefore we use the RTE write API. This API is handled inside the runtime environment of the Core 1. The Core 1 is aware that this data element must be transferred to the RTE on the Core 0. And therefore, it uses the IOC to transfer this data into a data buffer. And it informs the RTE on the other core that it is, or that a new data is available, which can be picked up now. Our component on the other core will read the data element. The RTE on the local core knows that this data is provided from the IOC, so it redirects this call to read this buffer where the data is stored. And of course, this buffer and this buffer is the same buffer. We've already heard that it may have a very huge impact where the data buffers for the variables and the source code is located, in which memories of the Rx. So Georg, maybe you can give us some more insights of the performance dependency.
Yeah, thank you, Michael. Thank you very much. Now we have seen how software can be partitioned into different cores. Now the simple question comes, how can the optimized performance be achieved? I was talking about at the beginning, to get the best possible performance, linear increase of performance along with the cores. Well, the answer is fairly simple. The code and data we have seen before that is assigned to partition 0 must now be assigned or located to the local memory of core 0. Similar for partition 1. Code and data we assigned to partition 1 must now be located to the local memory of core 1. Now, how can this be done? So, on the source code level, such location of code and data can be done in the C source code and in the linker script. For this purpose, we put pragmas in front of C objects like functions, data or constants to define linker input sections. And then we assign in the linker script these input sections to an output section that is located on the physical address of the local memory of core 1, 2 or 3 or so. Now this is surely good for bare metal applications, but in AutoSAR with the generated code for the RTE, etc., it is really not a good idea to start modifying the generated code. But with AutoSAR, the memory mapping concept, the generation of section symbols are also supported. And then the objects can be located to the current memory address, similar as shown above. Now Michael Reis gives an overview how this works with the Electrobit Tresus Studio. Michael, please go ahead.
Thanks, Georg, for this hint about the performance. So we saw that it may have a huge impact where the code or the variables are located. So how to realize it in an AutoSAR system in which the basic software isn't implemented by yourself? and must be considered as third-party software, which shouldn't be modified by your own. AutoStar has addressed this restriction, let's say, by introducing the so-called memory mapping concept. It is normally called MEMAP, which stands for memory mapping. The memory mapping concept in AutoStar provides the possibility that you can link variables or source code to a dedicated section. So you have the freedom to define a project-specific memory layout without modifying or touching the delivered basic software from ElectroBit. In the ElectroBit solution, there is an own module available, which is called MemMap, which can be also be configured in the eBitrisel Studio tooling. And this module simplifies the memory mapping in your project. On the left side, we can see a screenshot of some basic software mode manager code, which was generated for our demo project. Please pay attention to this information. Here we can see that, let's say, a define is used, which is called OS application core 0, start section var init unspecified. And after this define was implemented, the source code from ElectroBit includes a so-called memory mapping header file. And afterwards, some variables are defined. I have also added a screenshot from another part in the basic software mode manager. And this is a part for the basic software mode manager instance on the core 1. And here we can see that another define is used. Now it is called OS application core 1 instead of core 0. But afterwards, exactly the same approach is used. So the source code includes the MemMap header file, and it defines some variables which are used for its functionality. On the screenshot on the right side, we can see how to configure now the memory mapping in your project. So the MemMap generator from ElectroBit is aware of all the memory sections which are used from the basic software modules and from the application modules. You get a list of all sections which are used in this parameter memory map memory section ref. So now you can see here I have selected exactly this section which is used in the basic software mode manager source code. And now I have the possibility to assign a so-called MemMap addressing mode set ref to this section. The second screenshot shows the configuration of this addressing mode set ref. And here you have the possibility to define or to implement some project specific pragma instructions so that later on this variable will be located in a core local memory of the core 0. And this variable will be located in a core local RAM memory of the core 1. Let's have a look to the output, which is finally generated from this MemMap module from ElectroBit. This is in part of the MemMap file which is generated. So it says, if currently this value is defined, then an additional define is used, which is implemented here. And here we can see exactly the pragma instructions which were configured in advance. So now you can see it's very easy to link the variables which belongs to the core 0 or to the core 1 to the core local memory without modifying the source code, the delivered source code from ElectroBit. But finally, we want to switch back to our demo project. So we want to see if this demo project is really running on the hardware. We already know the software architecture of this demo project, and I just want to summarize a little bit the functionality of this demo project. So on the one hand, we already know that we have the software component data providers, one on each core, which provides an input value for our calculation component where an easy or a simple algorithm is implemented. We also know that this input value is also taken into account from every core to control some LEDs. So for each core, I have assigned 4 LEDs on the tri-board, and hopefully we will see that these LEDs will blink afterwards when we have downloaded the software. The modules which are involved in this data path are the software component data provider, core 1 or core 0 output, and then an I/O hardware abstraction which directly makes use of the DIO driver from Infineon. And of course also the port driver is involved in this data path. And our calculate component implements an algorithm which produces finally an output. This output is consumed from the component send to com, which finally sends the calculated value via the communication stack to some other nodes in the network. And here we can see that the communication stack for CAN is used. So we can see the CAN driver from Infineon and the CAN interface from Electrobit. And additionally, the same value is also transmitted via the Ethernet network. Here you can see all the Ethernet related modules in the AUTOSAR stack. In this short video, we can see the tri-board with the TC38X microcontroller, and we can already see that the different LEDs are blinking. Please remember that 4 LEDs are controlled from the core 0, 4 LEDs are controlled from the core 1. And you can also see that I have connected an Ethernet cable to the port, which goes to an Ethernet to USB converter. And also the Ethernet to USB converter is blinking. That means it looks like that there is an ongoing transmission of Ethernet frames. If you later on want to try or want to use this project by your own, I have just added some screenshots from the Trace 32 debugging that you get an impression which functions are invoked. So here we can see especially the invocation of the DIO functions. So the digital input output driver from Infineon is called, and we can see that it is called sometimes from the core 0, so this is the call stack here, and sometimes from the core 1. So the colors, the green color stands for the core 1, the red color stands for the core 0. The same is true for the execution of the software components. Of course, this hopefully fits to the assignment we have done during the configuration. So we can see that the software component calculate and the runnable which belongs to this component is executed on the core 1, and that the software component send to com and the runnable is executed on the core 0. And here we see finally the request to transmit the calculated value to the communication stack from AUTOSAR. And on the next slide, we can see the result. So you can connect the Ethernet adapter, or you can monitor, let's say, the Ethernet traffic with Wireshark. And you should see that the ECU software transmits periodically an Ethernet frame, and this Ethernet frame just contains one counter value, which is shown here. The source IP is our ECU. The destination IP is now my PC, let's say. Let me summarize the webinar a little bit. We talked about multi-core software architectures, which are realized by introducing so-called OS applications or partitions. So it's more or less exactly the same. But this is only one possible use case. Of course, there's a second use case where the usage of different partitions is required, even if you only use a single core microcontroller. And why could this be helpful? It could be helpful to ensure the so-called freedom from interference between the partitions. So if we have the goal that we want to prevent any unintended access between two partitions, then we can introduce the partitions and the ElectroBit basic software modules will take care that an unintended access will be prevented. Today, we mostly have to address both goals. So on the one hand, we have a very high functional feature set, and it is not sufficient to execute these features on a single core. So we need more computational power. And on the other hand, we may have several safety requirements, and we want to realize this freedom from interference approach. And this leads us, let's say, to a multi-core safety architecture. Let me summarize the points a little bit. So I hope we showed you that the combination of the Infineon RX microcontroller and the ElectroBit AUTOSA classic platform offers a powerful and easy to use environment for your ECU projects. We saw that it is possible to configure the whole basic software, that means the basic software from ElectroBit and also the Infineon microcontroller abstraction layer drivers in one tool. And we also saw that it is pretty simple to define the core assignment, so to define on which core the software components shall be executed. It is possible that you get the demo project we have used and presented during this webinar. If you are interested in this demo project, then just contact our sales department. You will get a free evaluation license for all the related products, and you will also get the project itself. If you are interested in, then please use a meaningful subject in your mail. Here it is mentioned that you shall use ElectroBit and Infineon multicore webinar. Please also insert your full name, title, the organization, and your telephone number in this email. And of course, it is also possible to download this video after the webinar. You can see the links here. Also, a PDF version of this webinar or of the slides shown in this webinar is available. So thank you very much for your attention. Now we are happy answering your questions about the RX hardware. Georg will answer these questions, or about the ElectroBit basic software and their multi-core usage. I will try to answer these questions.
Yeah, also thank you for your attention from the Infineon side, and we are waiting for your questions.